Well, good evening everyone. Welcome to this special event for the Laws Faculty, staff, students and alumni. Very pleased to see that we've got some alumni in the audience this evening. It's a lovely event. Philippe is in huge demand. I heard him on the telephone the other day recounting all of the various jurisdictions that he visited in about the last 7 days. It was quite extraordinary. But my understanding is that this is the first UK event that he's done on his new book, East West Street. Is that right?
UK academic event.
Oh, first UK academic event. Okay.
I wanted to make sure I did UCL before I did LSE.
Or did I say to you, you'd better do UCL before you do the LSE. We agreed that he would do UCL before he did the LSE. So the way that I planned it this evening, I'm going to do a bit of an introduction on Philippe, just in case there's anybody who doesn't know his biography. And then I'm going to make a few personal comments on the book. And what I want to do this evening is to give Philippe an opportunity to tell us more about the research that went into the book and the writing of the book, and then to give him a chance to reflect on some of the key themes in the book, and also to think a bit about what meaning it has for us in contemporary times, because we are living in unusual contemporary times. I think what we're going to do is have a conversation for about half an hour or so, and then allow some time for questions from the audience, which I'm sure you will have. So to start by introducing Philippe. Philippe joined the Faculty of Laws at UCL in January 2002 as Professor of Law and Director of the Centre on International Courts and Tribunals. Philippe's also a busy practicing barrister, and he practices from Matrix Chambers. His teaching areas include public international law, the settlement of international disputes, including arbitration, and environmental and natural resources law. As a practicing barrister, he appears before many international courts and tribunals, including the International Criminal Court and the International Court of Justice. In 1998, he acted for Human Rights Watch with Reedy Brodie on the Pinochet case at the House of Lords in London. In 2003, he was appointed a Queen's Counsel, and he's been appointed to lists of arbitrators maintained by ICSID and the PCA. Philippe, as many of you will know, is a regular commentator on the BBC and CNN, and he writes frequently for leading newspapers. He's vice president of the Hay Festival and a member of the board of English Pen and of the Tricycle Theatre. He's the author of Lawless World, which he published in 2005, and Torture Team 2008, which had a huge amount of publicity, as well as several academic books on international law. He also contributes regularly to the New York Review of Books, Vanity Fair, Financial Times, and The Guardian. This evening, we're discussing his new book, East West Street, on the Origins of Crimes Against Humanity and Genocide, published with the BBC Storyville film, My Nazi Legacy, What Our Fathers Did. Some of you in the audience, I think, may have been at a screening that we did for alumni and faculty a little while ago. That film is about the sons of Hans Frank and Otto von Wachter, who are central characters in the East West Street book. The book's been a tremendous success. It was only published, 3 months ago? It went straight onto bestseller lists. I was absolutely astonished at the speed with which it shot up the non-fiction lists. It's already been nominated for a number of prizes. It's been longlisted for the Cundill Prize in Canada, shortlisted for the Samuel Johnson Prize by Bailey Gifford, and shortlisted for the Best First Biography in the UK. It's had rave reviews both in this country and abroad. It's currently being translated into several foreign languages that will be rolled out in 2017, 18 and 19. It's currently being translated into German, Italian, Spanish, French, Turkish, Polish, and there are 4 others in negotiation. This is an astonishing record for a book that's really only been out and available for 3 months. One of the main spin-offs is the film that I mentioned just now, My Nazi Legacy, which was shown all around London. It was on release around London. I think that was nominated for a Best Documentary Prize, wasn't it? There's been a stage production, A Song of Good and Evil, which was performed at the National Theatre with Vanessa Redgrave and in other places around the world. And as I say, that film has also been nominated for prizes. So it is an astonishing project that Philippe has been engaged in for an academic. He's produced a tremendous piece of academic work, but it has had these extraordinary artistic spin-offs, so it's got its story out into the general public imagination, and has had an amazing response. So you really are to be congratulated very much on that success. Turning now to the book, these are my reflections. I am going to stop talking in a while and let Philippe talk, but I've got the floor for the moment. And I want to say something about my reaction to the book. So for me, there are two main stories in the book, but there are also several recurring and very important themes. The main story, one of the main stories, is the mystery regarding Philippe's family, who lived in what's variously known as Lviv, Lvov, and Lemberg in Poland. I'm sure I pronounced all of those wrongly, in the same in a town in Poland. So that's the first thing, it's a mystery story. But the second main story is about the development of key concepts in international law, the concepts of crimes against humanity and the concept of genocide. But the background for the telling of these stories about Philippe's family and about the development of these very important international law concepts, the background and the context for the telling of these stories is the occupation of Poland during World War II and the merciless annihilation of Jews, Polish intelligentsia, and many other groups. And also the competition between these concepts of crimes against humanity and genocide that were used during the Nuremberg trials in 1945, in which leaders of Nazi Germany were tried for their part in the atrocities that had taken place. Other strands in the book, which kind of appear throughout, are those of displacement and dislocation. There are extraordinary stories of survival. There are stories of survivor guilt, which is a constant theme that goes through the book, of the silence that accompanies survivor guilt, of the refusal to remember past horrors, which is why sometimes it's so difficult to put together what happened in the past. And for me, one of the things that comes out very clearly from the book, and which actually emerged, and I mentioned this after we had the screening of the film, it's an obvious thing to say, but what comes out again is the banality of evil, how apparently ordinary people living family lives are capable of astonishing brutality. And there are some visceral examples of that throughout the book. The starting point for the whole project is a rather surprising coincidence that Hirsch Lauterpacht, the world-famous professor of international law at Cambridge, who developed the concept of crimes against humanity. So Hirsch Lauterpacht, Raphael Lemkin, who was a prosecutor and lawyer who coined the term genocide, Leon Buchholz, Philippe Sand's grandfather, all of these three men lived in Lemberg in Poland around the time of World War II, but all managed to leave Poland before they could be caught up in the events that led to the destruction of all of their families during the Nazi occupation of Poland. I think it was 2007, but I'm not sure, Philippe was invited to give a lecture in Lemberg, Lviv, Lvov. Is that right? Was it 2007? 2010, sorry. In 2010, out of the blue, Philippe was invited to give a lecture in Lemberg on crimes against humanity and genocide by the law faculty of the University of Lvov, what had been Lviv, Lvov, Lemberg. The invitation led to the fascinating unravelling of family mystery and the exploration of the origins of these two key concepts of international law, and also involving a deep reflection on their meaning and difference. This is a brilliant book. It is a brilliant read. It reads like a thriller or a detective mystery. It's intellectually absorbing. It's heartbreaking. There are images in it. I won't go through them now, but there are images with it that really stick with me long after I'd finished reading it. But despite the horrors that are interlaced with legal analysis and historical detail, what Philippe demonstrates throughout the book is the lawyer's meticulous search for evidence, the academic's care for precision and thorough analysis, and the human rights activist's compassion and humanity. The structure of the book tells a series of stories of individuals in his family, of Lauterpacht, of Lemkin, of Hans Frank, who was the German lawyer and Governor General of occupied Poland, and finally it tells the story of the latter stages of the Nuremberg trial in 1945. All of these stories are told with conspicuous detachment, lack of emotion, and self-discipline. But it's not a pallid account, it's an unravelling that is consciously dispassionate, but leaves you with an extraordinary feeling and understanding for the time, the people, and of these very important concepts that emerge from that time and from the personal experiences of the men Lauterpacht and Lemkin who were so directly affected by those events. Also, ultimately, one of the things I saw was a grandson's love and wonder at the mysterious struggles endured by relatives both known and unknown. And despite the fact that you try to be extremely dispassionate, it still does creep through in there. It's in there somewhere. Anyway, so that's my account. That's what I took, or that's some of the things I took from the book. As you can see, it is an enormous book. It is a wonderful read, and you need to read every word of it because of the way that the stories kind of weave around. It's brilliant. So what I want you to tell us is a bit more about the genesis of the book, how you began the project, and then, this is a compound question which makes it difficult, and then how you arrived at the structure of the book, which I think is absolutely genius.
Sure. So, well, thank you. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for being here, Hazel. It's really wonderful to be here, and it's a mark of my gratitude, really, to UCL, who have supported me hugely over 6 years, faculty, staff, students. It's a product of being at UCL that I was given the time and the space to engage in what is not an orthodox academic project, I think it's fair to say. So as you said, I was toddling along doing my usual stuff, teaching, writing academic articles, doing books, doing the odd case, sitting as an arbitrator, beginning to do that. And out of the blue, I get this invitation from this bizarre city in the Ukraine, the city now called Lviv, which was before that Lvov when it was part of Poland, and before that was Lemberg. And the invitation says, would you come and deliver a lecture on the work that you do on genocide and crimes against humanity? And the work that I do includes both sort of an academic element. I've written books on those subjects. I teach those subjects in part on my courses on courts and tribunals, for example. But also I've done cases on genocide and crimes against humanity. I didn't have a burning desire to go and give yet another lecture on genocide and crimes against humanity, except that the invitation came from this obscure city. And the city was happened to be where my grandfather was born in 1904. And I just wanted to go and see the city. To understand my grandfather and my relationship with him, you need to know that he was born in 1904, and his life was really divided into two parts. Before 1939 and after 1945. And anything that happened before 1945, we grew up knowing nothing about. He lived until the year 1997. He was 94 years old when he died. And so I knew him very well. I knew him for more than 3 decades, but he never once talked about what had happened during the war and in that period. It was just a no-go area. So I grew up in a household where you just didn't talk about that period. So the invitation comes in, and of course my mum, who was born in 1938, didn't have any memory of that period. So she had also not been told by him very much, and she didn't have her own memory. So it was just a sort of blank slate for me and my brother. So I think, that'll be really interesting to go. I'm sort of curious to know where I come from. I'm curious to know where he was born, where he lived, the streets that he walked up. So I accept, and we set a date for the autumn, October of 2010, exactly 6 years ago. And I spend a bit of the summer doing research on it, and I make two discoveries that surprise me. The first is that the man who invented the concept of crimes against humanity, in the sense of being the person who introduced it into the Nuremberg Charter, Hirsch Lauterpacht, probably the most famous international lawyer of the 20th century, a former professor at Cambridge University, had lived in the city and had studied at the very same law school that I had been invited to, and no one at the law school was aware of that fact, which was pretty amazing. If that wasn't amazing enough, I then discovered, and you've guessed it straight away, that the second guy, Raphael Lemkin, who invented the word genocide, they both wrote books in the mid-1940s after the Second World War, had also lived in the same city and had also studied at the same university, and the people who'd invited me were unaware of it. So this, just thinking about it as an academic for a moment, this is pretty weird. You're asked to give a lecture on a particular subject, and you discover before you deliver the lecture that the originators in international law of the two subjects come from that place, which of course immediately makes you begin to turn your mind to what on earth was going on over there in that city to cause these two individuals. And of course I read myself in to the history of the area. It was an incredibly complex part of the world, a sort of fault line between East and West. And I learnt about the multiculturalism of the place, basically a city divided into three communities, Ukrainians, Poles, and Jews in roughly equal numbers, but also Armenians and others. Very, very integrated community in a sense, and essentially relatively peaceful community until the First World War broke out, and began to understand the context, which I write about in the book, about the lives that they led. Now, I came back, I gave the lecture, it was completely fascinating being there. It is an extraordinary city, basically unchanged at its heart since that period. All the buildings are still there. And I couldn't get out of my mind, you know, this sort of elements of coincidence between my own life and between the lives of these two men. They didn't overlap Lauterpacht and Lemkin, but they, with their Lauterpacht studied at the university from 1915 to 1919. It was one of the great law schools of the world, older than Harvard University. And Lemkin was there from 1921 until 1926. So they didn't actually overlap, but eventually I found all their student records, I found all the classes they took, and you could begin to deconstruct who the influences had been on them. And that sort of interested me as an academic and as a teacher. So eventually a book emerged, and as it began, it was going to be a book about three people: my grandfather Leon, Lauterpacht, and Lemkin. And then into the story emerged a fourth person, who in fact becomes, I think, one of the most important characters in the book, because he's the linking character between the three other men and their families. His name is Hans Frank. He was Adolf Hitler's personal lawyer from 1928 until 1933. He was then appointed Bavarian Minister of Justice, very highly educated, and then in 1939 becomes Governor General of Occupied Poland. A couple of years later, Galicia and Lemberg are integrated into the territory of the Government General and Occupied Poland, and Frank arrives in the city of Lemberg, which it's now called once again, because it's under German occupation. And on the 1st of August 1942, at the university, in the aula, in a room that is equivalent to this — those of you who've seen my Nazi legacy will have seen the room — he gives a great speech, a big speech, in which he announces the imposition of the final solution and the extermination of all the Jews in the city. And of course, what follows 2 weeks later and in the ensuing weeks is that the families of my grandfather, of Lauterpacht and Lemkin, are completely exterminated. There is one survivor in each family. That's one point they have in common. Fast forward 3 years, and Frank is caught and becomes defendant number seven at the famous Nuremberg trial, the main trial. He's on the front bench, six down from Hermann Göring. Many of you know the famous photographs of that trial. And amazingly, Lauterpacht and Lemkin are hired by, respectively, the British and American governments to join the prosecution teams. And they find themselves prosecuting Hans Frank. Lauterpacht on crimes against humanity, and Frank and Lemkin on genocide. What they do not know when the trial opens on the 20th of November 1945 is that the man they're prosecuting is the man who's responsible for the killings of their entire families. They do not know when the trial opens whether anyone is alive or not. And indeed, the first day of the trial deals with events in Lemberg in the period immediately following Frank's visit. So you almost couldn't invent the sort of confluence of facts that emerge in this particular story. I'm not going to obviously go into all of the detail, but as I carried on with the research, and it took about 6 years, the points of coincidence became really remarkable. And just to illustrate how they came, and I knew nothing about this when I started, when I accepted the invitation. It was all completely unknown to me. I learned in the course of the research that the first street on which my grandfather's mother, my great-grandmother, walked was in a small town called Zhulkiev, about 25 kilometers from Lemberg, but north of Lemberg. She was born there, and Lauterpacht was born there, and they both lived on the same street. And they that street was called Lemberger Straße. It was a town of a population of about 4,500, so it's a sort of, you know, coincidence of sorts, and the street that she was born on was Lemberger Straße, which was the same street that Lauterpacht lived on. That is a street that was described by the writer Joseph Roth as East-West Street, hence the title in the book. Fast forward more than 100 years, and who is my first teacher of international law but Eli Lauterpacht, the son of Hirsch Lauterpacht, the only child of Hirsch Lauterpacht. So there's a sort of strange point of connection that comes together. And then I learn that the last street on which my great-grandmother walks is also the last street on which Lemkin's parents walk, a street called Himmelfahrtstraße, the street to heaven, which was the street that led from the rail platform at Treblinka to the gas chamber at Treblinka. It was a bit of a surprise to discover that within 2 weeks, my great-grandmother and Lemkin's beloved mother, Bella, and his beloved father, Joseph, had been killed in exactly the same place, having walked down exactly the same street. So, in a sense, my professional life, deeply influenced by the intellectual ideas of these two men, is also very curiously bookended in a geographic sense by the lives of their families. So you've got in this book a vast amount of material. And coming to your question about the structure of it, it's a complicated book to write. I started writing it in about 2011 and then gave it to my agent, who then sent it out. And it went straight to my American agent in New York, who said, I know exactly who I'm going to give it to. There is one editor who's absolutely right for this book. What I didn't know at the time, I mean, the coincidences just abound, is that my agent in America, whose name is Melanie Jackson, and who I'd known for 5 years, is actually the granddaughter of Robert Jackson, the chief prosecutor at the very trial I was describing in the book. And when I sent her the manuscript, she sent me a sweet little email a couple of weeks later and said, remarkable, it seems that my father and grandfather are the only two people in the world who both worked with Lauterpacht and Lemkin. And you find references in her family correspondence to both men. So these points of connection, which may or may not be coincidental, how does one explain this, were there. The manuscript went to an editor at Alfred Knopf in the United States, not an academic publisher, but probably the most famous publishing house in the United States, and a remarkable editor called Victoria Wilson. And for the academics amongst you and the law writers amongst you, I've certainly learnt a thing or two about writing. To give you a sense of how it has evolved, and it was 5 years in the hands of Vicky Wilson. When she got the first draft, it was already 125,000 words back in 2011, 2012. But the narrative was written chronologically. It started in 1914 and it went to the last day of the Nuremberg trial, the judgment, on October the 1st, the last day, second day of the judgment, October the 1st, 1946, exactly 70 years ago. And it interwove these four stories. And Vicky Wilson said, no, I'll buy this book, but I impose two conditions. The first condition is that you will completely restructure it and rewrite it in the following way. The human mind cannot cope with information presented in that way. The way the human mind can work, dealing with such issues of complexity, is to take each story separately, the lives of the four men separately, up until the first day of the Nuremberg trial. And that is essentially the first part of the book. And the second half, or the second last third of the book, is you then bring the lives together in the course of the trial. I take no credit for that idea. That was the idea of Vicky Wilson. And the second condition that she imposed was that the book not be sold to a British publishing house until she had finished with it. And that took 4.5 years, and it was then bought by Weidenfeld and Nicholson. And for nearly 5 years, for each of 4 years, I would send a draft that I thought was pretty good. And she would respond after about a month and say, very good, excellent, you've followed all my suggestions, but I think this needs another draft. I look forward to hearing from you in a year's time. And that is how it works. And it says a lot about how we write as lawyers, both as counsel or as judges or as scholars writing academic articles or books. We don't really know how to write. I'm going to say that in general, there are exceptions. There are notable exceptions to that. But being in the hands of a very serious editor of 40 years has taught me a lot about how you communicate complexities of ideas in a way that an intelligent but non-legally qualified reader can understand. And in a sense, the source of greatest happiness for me of the book is the very large number of emails that I receive from people who begin by saying, I'm not a lawyer, but I thought all this stuff about the law was completely fascinating. And that, I think, is a credit. I don't take credit for that. That goes to Vicky Wilson. But essentially, you've got two detective stories interweaving in parallel. The story of what happened to my family, which we can come back to if you want, and which is the personal story, obviously very important for me and about 10 people around me, and the big intellectual, legal, political story of how did these concepts of international crimes come into being, and why did the distinction between individuals and groups, crimes against humanity and genocide, come into being at that moment in July and August 1945? What was the intellectual debate taking place, and what does it tell us about who we are?
I think the structure of the book is amazing. I said that to you when we spoke the other day. I just thought it was the most brilliant construction. Makes it compelling, very readable, and very comprehensible.
And I'm taking no credit for it.
Okay, we've got that. We've recorded this, so we know you're taking no credit. I've got so many questions to ask you, but one thing that I'm interested in is that it struck me there's a huge amount in the book, but you did a massive amount of research and work. How did you decide what to put in? Or more importantly, is there anything that you left out that you now wish that you had put in?
Yeah. I mean, we all of us, when we write, whether it is as a law student writing an exam or an essay, a barrister or solicitor writing a pleading, a judge writing a judgment, a writer writing a book or an article or something, we take information and something happens in the way we process that information. We don't often ask ourselves the question, as lawyers and legal academics, how will the reader perceive what we have written? You do it a bit as counsel. I do it. When I'm in an international court, I now, and I have long, asked myself the question, not how can I persuade these judges who are before me, but rather, how are they going to react to my presentation of information? And we all know that we are selective. We don't put out everything that we've found. We choose what we're going to include and how we are going to exclude certain information. And that process is an immensely complex process. And it's the reason that there is no such thing as objectivity. Every microcosm of a decision is subjective. It involves a series of choices which are justified by individual, group, personal, intellectual, professional matters. But every act of writing is, in effect, an act of advocacy. It's an act of encouragement to bring the reader into the text, and an act of persuasion to try to bring the reader along with you. And I don't think it matters whether it's a judgment or an essay or a book or an article. I think the same principles essentially apply. And so what happens as you embark on a project like this, which is, as you've heard, not a project in which I said, right, I'm going to write a book about these four men and these two issues and this one city. No. You open a door. The first door is marked Lviv University. You fly there, you meet 25 people, and in the course of meeting 25 people, you have 74 interesting discussions, and you pick up 147 pieces of information. And for some reason that one can never quite understand, certain pieces of information stick in your mind, and they cause you to follow up what has happened, what has been told to you. And that leads to another place with three more doors, and you have to choose which door you're going to open and go into. And you make a selection, you go into that door, and that door leads to yet another place. Now, how that happens, I have no idea. I mean, we can take a particular example and explore why you chose to go there. So, for example, why did I go to Zhulkiev? Well, if I trace back, Zhulkiev is about 25 kilometers from Lemberg, and I really wanted to go on the first visit. And the reason I really wanted to go on the first visit was not anything to do with Lauterpacht. I didn't even know that Lauterpacht was born there at the point, but because on my grandfather's birth certificate that I found, my mother gave it to me a couple of weeks before we went out to Lviv. I brought her along with me. In the birth certificates of that day, the birthplace of the parents was also mentioned. And so I saw it, and I happened to retain the services of a guide in the city, a sort of professional historian type person. And I asked him, how far is Zhulkiev? He said, actually, it's called Zhovkva now. It's a different place. It's a different name. But I'll take you. It's only 20 minutes by car. And that conversation opened that door. I can't take credit for having, a process of intellectual decision-making that's where I want to go, that's where I'm going to find stories, but it was a series of accidents. And so you go in a particular direction, and you accumulate and accumulate and accumulate, and every door you open leads to another place, and there are four more doors, and you make choices to go into those doors, and after 3 years, you're just sitting on a mass of information. And there's a part of your brain that is finding points of connection. I wish I could say, like Lemkin, I had a series of little filing cards in which I wrote absolutely everything down. My brain doesn't work like that. I sort of don't really take those kinds of notes. But I have points of recollection, and that is what leads to the points of connection being made. In terms of the question, did I leave things out? If I take the family story is a very delicate story. My grandfather leaves Lemberg in 1914, I discover. He's a 10-year-old boy. He leaves with his mother and his two sisters in September 1914, a few days before the Russians occupy the city. They capture the city in the middle of 1915. And he leaves because his brother has been killed in the war, in the First World War, as part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. He's killed and he leaves. His dad stays behind, and his dad then dies, apparently, of a broken heart through the loss of his eldest son. And he goes to Vienna, and he makes a life for himself in Vienna. He becomes a distiller of alcohol, of liqueurs, and there's no one in my side of the family who has any legal connections, legal background. I'm the first on that side of the family who even went to university. There's no great sort of hinterland of in that kind of background. And then, of course, he eventually finds a wife, my grandmother, in 1937, and in 1938, they produce a child, my mother. My mother's born in July 1938, 3 months after the Anschluss, the moment where the Nazis, the Germans, annexed Austria. Terrible time to be born if you're Jewish. What happens next is a matter of silence. No one will talk about what happened next. What I discover going through the documents in my mother's papers, which she had never shown me until I was 50 years old, I was totally unaware of these papers, was I work out that they didn't leave together. I thought they had left together. My grandfather leaves first. In January 1939, he makes his way to Paris. Then my mother follows by herself in July 1939, aged one. You know, work it out. How on earth does she get from Vienna to Paris? My mother has no idea. So that story needs to be cracked, and I crack it. And what I learn, to cut to the chase, is that she's been saved by an evangelical Christian missionary from Norwich, an absolutely remarkable lady called Elsie Tilney, who is motivated. I've come to know her community, which still exists in Norwich, the Surrey Chapel. I've been there. I've even preached a sermon there. I've got to know them there. Absolutely wonderful people. Elsie Tilney, was influenced by a sermon given by her pastor, David Panton, in 1935, which took a particular interpretation of a single line in Paul's letters to the Romans, chapter 10, verse 1. Putting it another way, my mother and I owe our existence to Elsie Tilney's slightly curious interpretation of a single line in Paul's letter to the Romans. Literally, you could not invent the stuff. But my grandmother stays behind. My mother leaves by herself. And I know this is a matter that is very delicate for my mother. Why did my grandmother stay behind? And of course, what I eventually get to is that there are two love stories that have taken place. Basically, they've been having affairs. And astonishingly, with the passage of 70 years, this is an amazing thing what you can find out. I find out the identity of all of the people concerned and track them all down. But in the context of all of this, in terms of subject matters left out, I came across very delicate material, and there was a very complex set of issues to decide for myself as to whether I would put them in or not. In particular, the question of doing a DNA test as to who was my biological grandfather, because that issue arose. So dealing with that in a book like this is obviously sensitive. I won't go any further. You'll be able to work out once you've read it what I leave in and what I leave out, what I don't leave in, what I don't leave out. But at each point, there are choices that you make, and the choices that you make are motivated by different considerations. Will it hurt someone who is a living person? Will it help explain an intelligent, non-legal lay reader why a particular moment in a complex trial was or was not important? Is it interesting? Does it add colour that is important for understanding the totality? But the question of why you choose to leave things in or out in any written text is a really fascinating and incredibly complex issue.
I want to move you on to the central issues in relation to international law, the difference between crimes against humanity, or in a sense the competition between what seemed to me to be a kind of competition between crimes against humanity and the concept of genocide. And these are terms that we are familiar with now, but I'm interested to know the extent to which you have a preference. Certainly in the book, you make strong arguments about why the concept of genocide may not in the end be all that helpful and crimes against humanity is better. Perhaps you can just say something about that.
So the heart of the book is a big, big question for all of us. And it is this: who are we? Who am I? Am I an individual? Am I a member of a group? Am I both? Why does the difference matter? Go back to January 1945. At that point, there was no rule of international law in place which said that a state could not exterminate a portion of its population. States were entirely free, as a matter of international law, to decide to kill, to maim, to torture, to disappear, to cause mayhem. The extraordinary change that took place, a revolutionary change, took place in the summer of 1945. Combination of the United Nations Charter, the work of various governments, but in particular, and it's a big theme of the book, the fundamental role that individuals can play in effecting change. Lauterpacht writes a book that is published in the summer of 1945 called An International Bill of the Rights of Man. It is the basis of modern human rights. It's the first academic book that sets out the proposition that all human beings have minimum rights under international law because they are human beings, irrespective of who they are. Unbelievably, and at every event that I do, people say that can't be right, that was only invented in 1945. It was only invented in 1945. And so Lauterpacht's thesis is the way you use the law to protect the well-being of human beings is to focus on their characteristics as an individual and to say that at all times every human being has minimum rights which deserve protection irrespective of who they are or where they are or what they have been doing. And that concept of individual human rights is incorporated into the concept of crimes against humanity, which is focused on the protection of individuals against systematic, widespread, unlawful killing as individuals in a large scale. Juxtapose the concept of the individual with the protection of the group. Lemkin says, well, hang on a second, that's all fine, all well and good, but actually, that's not how the world works. People don't get killed in large numbers because of their individual qualities. They get killed because they are a member of a despised group. It could be indigenous Indian, it could be Polish, it could be Roma, it could be Jewish, it could be Muslim, it could be Christian. It doesn't matter what it is. Large-scale killing is concerned with the destruction of groups, and the law must reflect that reality. That's Lemkin's thesis. And so he invents the word genocide in a book that is published in November 1944, Axis Rule in Occupied Territories. Chapter 9 includes the word genocide. First time he's invented it, first time it exists. And so over the next 2 years, certainly, but also over the next 70 years, there is this fundamental tension between the individual and the group. The essential difference in law is that if 100,000 people are killed unlawfully and systematically, that will inevitably and always be a crime against humanity. But it will not always be a genocide, because to prove a genocide, you have to demonstrate in a court of law that the people have been killed with the intention of destroying the group of which they happen to form a part, in whole or in part. Okay, so you've got a tension between these two crimes. Now, what has happened in the intervening 70 years is that genocide has gone to, if you like, to the top of the pyramid. If President Obama says that what is happening to the Yazidis in northern Iraq is a genocide, it will be on page one of the newspapers. If he calls it a crime against humanity, it probably won't be in the newspapers at all. Something has happened. I'm not sure why it has happened in that particular way, that has created a sort of hierarchy of crimes. And the group has, if you like, been elevated above the protection of the individual. And that has had consequences. And I've seen those consequences for myself firsthand in prosecuting cases of genocide. I've been in a room with a president, with a foreign minister, with a prime minister, and when you explain that to prove genocide is much more difficult because individuals and states generally don't tend to leave pieces of paper lying around, with the exception of the Germans, saying we intend to destroy all these people as part of a plan to eliminate that group. You're left to prove it by inference, which is a very, very difficult thing to do. And as you go through that conversation, what you notice is that there's a sort of psychological element of the reinforcing of them and us. In other words, the concept of genocide is premised on a recognition of a situation that there are those people over there who have certain qualities, and there's us over here who have these qualities, and they try to do this to us. And the mere act of prosecuting the crime of genocide, in my view, tends to reinforce the very conditions that cause the events to happen in the first place. Which is why where I end up is in a very complex, conflicted place. Intellectually, I'm with Lauterpacht. I think that we ought to be focusing on the protection of individuals. But I can't get away from the reality that Lemkin has a point. People don't get killed because of their individual qualities, and the law needs to reflect that sense of group identity. And that creates a fundamental problem. If the crime that has been given a name of genocide tends in its application to give rise to the very conditions that it seeks to alleviate, is it a useful thing to have done? And that is a big question. Interestingly, when Lemkin's book came out, he received a letter 2 months later by a remarkable Austrian emigre in the United States, a man called Leopold Kohr, an academic who actually went on later in life to teach international relations at Aberystwyth, and who was the teacher of a man called E.F. Schumacher, Small is Beautiful. And Kohr wrote a vitriolic letter to Lemkin. It's undated, but it must be about the summer of 1945. I found it in Lemkin's archives, in which he points the finger at Lemkin and says, you have chosen the same path as Hitler. Your path may not inevitably lead to the same place as Hitler's, but the use of the word genocide takes a biological conception of the function of law, and that is inherently problematic. And I haven't ever been able to shake off the force of that letter. You know, you see certain documents, why you keep certain things in and certain things out, they leave a mark that you can't quite shake off. And that tension between the individual and the group, between us and them, permeates the whole of modern international law, actually, and modern international criminal law. And Lauterpacht's view was that the concept of genocide would replace the tyranny of the state, which is what individual human rights was intended to escape, with the tyranny of the group. And my own sense is that he was probably not wrong.
And which leads on neatly to another question I was going to have, which is implications for where we are now. Looking at reading the book, reading some of the discourse, the rhetoric around that time, one has this kind of chilling feeling on the spine about some of the things that we have heard in the post, during the Brexit debate and in this post-Brexit era that we're in now.
So I'm very careful in treating with this subject because I'm conscious that I have spent 6 years utterly immersed in the period between 1914 and 1946, and it may be that I am no longer capable of seeing the wood from the trees. But I have to say, on your question, it is impossible now, where I sit, not to see certain parallels. When we have a government that puts out a policy, and it was a policy, I've seen the emails. Theresa May is wrong to say it was not a policy. It was a policy for institutions, for corporations, for law faculties to list people who work for them on the basis of whether they are foreign or British is how it begins. It is how it begins. If you go back to Lemberg In the 1920s, that's how it starts. If you go back to Germany in 1933, that is the first thing that happens. You distinguish between human beings on certain bases that denies their essential characteristics as a human being. You're a foreigner, you're a Brit, you're a European, you're this, you're that. And that has emerged, and that is now part of our political discourse. And I think there's a very big question as to how that has been permitted to happen. I've been very confused, in a good way, about why it is that this book has resonated way beyond what I expected, way beyond what our publishers expected, my publishers expected, in the US or in the UK. And I think part of the answer to that is that it has the misfortune of being published at a moment when the issues that it addresses at its heart are back in political and public consciousness. We are hurtling back to the 1930s. And the reason we're hurtling back to the 1930s is that the generation that remembered where we came from and the world as it was in 1945 have gone. And our new politicians have no sense of history. They think that somehow you can ignore everything that has come before, that it's a different world now. It is not a different world. If you want one point of detail that really touches me, it's the nature of Lemberg in the interwar years, a bustling, multicultural metropolis in which communities got on pretty well together. There were issues, there were differences, but essentially there was not conflict, there was certainly not bloody conflict. And what happened 20 years later is that was totally wiped out. And communities and individuals who thought they were comfortable and safe, being university teachers, being doctors, being municipal mayors, and thought that they lived in a stable environment, learnt very, very, very quickly that things can change instantaneously. And there's one image that most sticks in my mind on that. It was one of the teachers that Lauterpacht and Lemkin both had was a man called Morris Allerhand. He was probably the most famous professor of civil and criminal procedure in Poland at that period. And he was both Polish intellectual and Jewish. And so he was very soon after the Germans arrived in June 1941, locked up, incarcerated in a concentration camp. And in that camp, he lost his life. And he lost his life in circumstances that have really stood in my mind. He came across in that camp a group being beaten with a pistol, sort of whipped with a pistol by a German soldier. And Allerhand, old Professor Allerhand, asked the German soldier a simple question. It was witnessed by one person who survived and who then told the story afterwards. He said to the German soldier, "Have you no soul?" And you can imagine this elderly academic raising that question. The consequence was that the soldier simply took his gun, put it at his head, and pulled the trigger, and that was it. And you have in a single moment like that an entire world disappearing. A man who's taught generations of students at a law faculty in a room just like this. It's a very personal story in a sense, because you realize it could happen to anyone. And it does happen. It continues to happen around the world today. In, you know, Iraq today, in Syria today, in the Congo, in ex-Yugoslavia, we know of similar stories. So it's not particular to that part of the world or to that time or to the German. I think anyone could do it. And that kind of anecdote illustrates for me that we cannot for a moment take for granted the settlement that we have in the United Kingdom today. And we should be acutely concerned about what is happening in this country. I can illustrate it very easily. I had lunch today with one of my PhD students, and she said to me, "I am scared, Philippe, to go outside London." Okay, this is a non-British national. How tragic that in 2016, a highly intelligent, highly educated individual could feel that it is no longer safe to venture out of the bubble of London because of the thoughts and views that are held. And that is how it begins. I mean, I don't want to get over dramatic about it, but it's incredibly worrisome what is going on right now. Incredibly worrisome.
Absolutely. I'm going to hand it over to the audience in a moment, but I've got one more question that struck me again on rereading, and that I find mildly alarming as well. Not alarming, but I would like to hear your comments on it. I was struck by the image of Hans Frank around the time when he was Governor General, just before he was about to put into practice the final solution, giving lectures on the rule of law and the importance of an independent judiciary. It reminded, and the fact that Lemkin went through all of the ways that the rights of groups, minority groups, were removed, how people were dehumanized, all absolutely legally. It reminded me of when I was in the Apartheid Museum in Johannesburg, standing before a wall that has every single law that was passed in order to deprive blacks and coloureds of every right that they had. This is all done under the rule of law, legally. So, I don't know if you have anything to say
about
that.
Well, I mean, it remains the great mystery. I mean, how could it be done? I don't think I'm any closer to having an answer to that question. Hans Frank was highly educated. He went to the best law schools in Germany. He was a friend of many of the great writers in Germany. He was a friend of many of the great composers. He was a personal friend of Richard Strauss's. I mean, this was a highly cultured, highly intelligent man. In the summer of 1942, after his office has offered to host the final solution at the Wannsee Conference, held in January 1942 in Berlin, he offers his territory to carry out the final solution. He has a sort of wobble. And in the summer of 42, May, June, July, he gives a series of four lectures in the great law schools of Berlin, arguing for the independence of the judiciary at these difficult times, even in times of war and conflict. And the consequence of giving those lectures are that he receives a personal call from Adolf Hitler, in which Hitler tells him he is stripping him of all his offices and all his baubles, with the exception of being Governor General of occupied Poland, which he hangs on to. At that moment, he also meets or reconnects with his childhood sweetheart. He's been married by now for 20 years. He has five children. And Lily Grau, whose family has refused to allow him to marry their wonderful daughter 20 years earlier, writes to him and says, my son is lost on the Eastern Front. With all your power and influence, could you intervene to see if you can find him? They reunite. He has a stonking great affair. And he decides that he wants to divorce his wife. Okay? So having just given these four big lectures, in the very same period, the very same days, he tells his wife that he wants a divorce. And he gives as the reason for his divorce the following. He says to his wife, darling Brigitte, I am about to become involved in something so terrible, final solution, so criminal, that it would be better for you if you were to distance yourself from me and divorce yourself from me. Okay? And she says, no, I'm going to stick with you, however terrible are the things you do. And you just pause and imagine the mind of a man, highly educated, highly cultured, who at the same moment, on the one hand, one part of his brain is giving these lectures on the independence of the judiciary and the rule of law, and another part of his brain is using the final solution to get a divorce. And you just wonder, how can such things happen? And it's almost impossible to understand how it happens, but it's a lesson, I think, for us on the weakness of the human spirit and the human soul, that such things can happen with highly articulate, highly educated, highly intelligent individuals who, at the end of the day, are fundamentally weak. And that, I think, is another parallel with what is going on now. It's impossible to escape the sense right now that decisions are being taken by individuals that are essentially unprincipled, motivated by the desire for personal advancement. I won't mention any particular foreign secretaries, but it's, you know, you can see parallels on a different scale, but you can see the kinds of compromises that are made in the name of personal advancement and personal well-being as opposed to the greater good. And that's another point of comparison, I think, that is very problematic.
And the dangers for society of those kinds of actions. I'm going to open it up to the floor now if people have got questions for Philippe about the book. Yep, there.
What do you think your grandfather would say about if he read this book? Would he be pleased?
He was a very, very private person. One of the points of commonality, it's very striking. My grandfather, my mother, Ellie Lauterpack's father. Ellie told me that Ellie was my teacher. He's very elderly now. I see him very regularly. He told me that his father never once talked to him about the Nuremberg trial, never once told him about what had happened to the family. It was simply a no-go area. Nicholas Frank, the son of Hans Frank, and I've come to know Nicholas very well, and he's become a very good friend, says it's the same thing on that side of the story. Cloaked in silence. No one wants to talk about these things. So I think for that generation, the reaction to this kind of a book would be a troubled reaction, because they would not wish to see these kinds of issues aired in any way in public. So I suspect he would be uncomfortable. He's not around, so I didn't need to worry so much about his level of discomfort beyond issues of sort of reputation type thing. But it mattered much more in the case of my mother, who was extremely anxious about the book that I was writing. And at each stage I was going through it, of course, I shared with her where I was going, what I was finding, what I was coming across. And interestingly, she's come out of it, having lived a life of, you know, more than 75 years in total silence about this period, feeling very pleased that the book has been written and that it's had the reaction that it's had. And both my brother and I have talked a lot about that, that it sort of, you know, lanced a sort of boil. It could have got, I think it could have gone the other way, but it went that way, and that's a good thing. But I suspect not very comfortable.
Just to pick up on this idea of the way that the climate genocide is crystallized and this idea of being about groups, the thought that I had was, I wonder whether it's a feature of the peculiar circumstances, the unusual feature of the Holocaust, the Nazis documented so carefully their desire to wipe out the Jews, to preserve bits of Jewish culture as an example of what was there before and what they'd exterminated. And then I wonder, because you've expressed your discomfort with part of the way in which genocide is crystallized, I wonder whether if we were coming up with something similar now to describe it, the Yazidis, or after, you know, the other examples of the, you know, the second half of the 20th century, whether we'd have done something slightly different.
Well,
what the crime might have looked like if it was anything other than the Nazis.
Well, it's a really excellent question, because actually I'm so divided on this issue that I'm contradictory in terms of what I do. So right now I'm very involved in the issues of northern Iraq, and in particular the treatment of Yazidi women and young girls, young women and girls, which is a truly shocking story. 14th of August 2014, or 5th of August 2014, ISIS-Daesh takes over swathes of territory, including a town called Sinjar, and immediately separates the men and the women who are of Yazidi religious origin, and then separates out the older women and the younger women, and in relation to the younger women, engages in a systematic program of enslavement, torture, and rape, right on an industrial scale. I have spent time with a group of 30 of these women who now live in Germany, and I have to tell you, when you spend time with a 14-year-old or a 15-year-old who tells you she was raped more than 600 times in the space of 6 months, it's an incredibly tough thing. Well, it's an appalling thing to have gone through. It's a tough thing even to be with someone who looks you in the face and says that that is what has happened. But I've come to know them through a remarkable German psychologist. I wrote a profile of him in the Financial Times, a man called Jan Kieselhahn, who sought me out precisely because he wanted to put on the agenda, as part of the psychological program of restoring some sense of well-being for them, the idea of justice. He believes that for people who've been through mass atrocity, it's incredibly important that they at least permit themselves the possibility that there might one day be justice in some form heaped upon the people who did these terrible crimes to them. And the reason that he sought me out, ironically enough, is that for him, crimes against humanity was not enough. He wanted the investigations, which are underway now, to be for the crime of genocide. Why? Because, he explained, in the crime of genocide, you have the element of group identity. And part of the psychological state of well-being for the people who've been on the receiving end of these horrors is to understand that they are part of a group that is respected and legitimized by the international community. And only genocide offers that. And I have to say, when he said that to me, I just thought, yeah, that's right. I mean, I really understand what Lemkin was on about. It's basically saying, we value you, Yazidi women and girls, because you are a member of a community we care about and we wish to protect. So I'm sure we would come up with a variation of the same concept, because that argument is a compelling argument. It's the argument that persuaded Lemkin. It's the argument that Lemkin used to then persuade states to adopt what was the first modern human rights treaty, the Convention of 1948 on the Prevention and Punishment of Genocide. The first modern human rights treaty after the non-binding Universal Declaration on Human Rights adopted in 1948. They were adopted on December the 9th and 10th, I think, 1948, in parallel. People were not ready to enshrine the protection of individuals in law, they were ready to enshrine the protection of groups in law. And that conversation with Jan Kieselhahn has very much stayed with me. So I think we would have to come up with some equivalent concept. I mean, the alternative way, of course, is to think about crimes against humanity as part of a genus, and then there'd be an aggravated crime against humanity motivated by the intent to destroy a particular group. But the reality is, it's too late. The word genocide exists, it works its magic. It has a way of making us imagine horror in a way that the term crimes against humanity just doesn't. Crimes against humanity is too technical, formalistic, legalistic. Genocide operates our imagination, and Lemkin's magic is to have come up with a word that captures our imagination for total horror. So it's not going to go away, it's not going to disappear. What is happening right now, and I think it's a good thing in terms of a rebalancing, is that the International Law Commission is right now negotiating a convention on crimes against humanity. There's no convention on crimes against humanity, and that's being negotiated and prepared right now by the International Law Commission. So I think we'd end up probably in pretty much the same place.
You are pretty ambivalent on it, aren't you?
I'm very torn. The one thing I'm not torn about is that if I had to choose whether to spend an evening having dinner with Lauterpacht or Lemkin, I would definitely choose Lemkin. Absolutely fascinating, fascinating human being.
Interesting. I've got a couple here. Will you? Okay, go ahead.
I've got two short questions. First one regards genocide. Don't you think it's a problem with having difficulty calling genocide is because of the definition of intent that was incorporated in the Prevention of Genocide Convention? Had we left that term loose, it would have been much easier to prove genocide today. Having left jurors and lawyers argue for seven decades about whether intent was proven or not. And the second one, if I may, regards the position of English law today on aggression. Don't you think it's odd that 70 years ago, the Nuremberg Tribunal defined aggression as the most heinous of international crimes, that the Supreme Court today in England says it's not actionable because Parliament has legislated?
So on the first question, I mean, intent is obviously one issue, how you prove intent, but there's also a sort of a threshold issue. Is genocide a numbers game? I mean, it is and it isn't. If you go through Lemkin's writings, you will see that for Lemkin, if you took a village of 12 people, six of one group and six of another group, and the six from one group kill all the six of the other group, that's a genocide. And he did not, for him, it didn't have to be hundreds of thousands or millions. He set the threshold very low. I tried to make that argument at the International Court of Justice in the case of Croatia and Serbia a couple of years ago, and the court just swatted it away. They want to set it up on a high threshold. But even then, it leads to some ridiculous, ridiculous situations. I was asked a couple of years ago to be on an advisory panel on something called Holocaust Memorial Day, which is an annual event, and which also commemorates other mass killings and atrocities. And I asked rather innocently, on what basis do you decide which other mass atrocities and killings you will honour and commemorate? And they said, oh, we've got a whole formula for that. Foreign Office has told us how we must do it. And basically, we'll only commemorate an act of killing or acts of mass killing if an international court has described it as a genocide. So I said, oh, does that mean then that you will commemorate the killing of 8,000 people in Srebrenica, but you will not commemorate the killing of 3 million people in the Democratic Republic of Congo? Yes, they said. That's exactly right. So, you know, what is the sense of that? What's the logic? What's the policy rationale for such an approach? And it raises, I think, you know, another category of very fundamental questions. The crime of aggression, I mean, I think the court was right, I'm afraid. We have a situation in our system where if Parliament has not legislated and you can't show that it's a rule of customary international law, that has become part of the domestic law, that is the law of the land. And what would be ideal would be for Parliament to legislate the crime of aggression, but it has not yet done so. And in the absence of such a decision by the Parliament of the United Kingdom, I don't think the courts, presided over in that case by the eminent, wonderful, lovable, brilliant Tom Bingham, could have done anything differently, faced with the facts and the law as it then was. I share your policy concern, but I would never criticise the court for having done what it did, because they got law right in an unfortunate circumstance.
Other questions? So there's you there, and then I'll come to you. Go ahead. I'm sorry. I thought you'd given up.
Oh, no.
Okay, go ahead.
No, it was a transition, and the transition took about 12 or 13 years. What had happened, I'd written sort of normal academic books published by CUP and OUP, and I'm very proud of those books, and if I had my career again, I'd write all of those books again, books that I love having written. And then in the autumn of 2003, I went to a dinner party in London, and I sat next to an editor at Penguin. And the editor asked me what I did, and I said I was a lawyer, I was a legal academic, taught at UCL, I just joined UCL. And she said, oh, well, you know, what sort of stuff do you do? And, you know, saying you're a lawyer and a legal academic generally is a big turnoff. It's not it's not an exciting thing to say at a dinner party when you're there with journalists and writers and film people or whatever. And then she said, "Oh, what sort of law do you do?" And I said, "Well, actually, I sort of deal with mass killing. And actually, I've been very involved in the whole Iraq thing and the Attorney General's legal advice." And she said, "Oh, well, that's interesting. People care about that, not just lawyers. Everyone cares about that." And she said, "There and then, if you can send me next Friday a 10-page proposal for a book that would be for an intelligent, non-academic audience on Iraq and related things, I'll publish it at Penguin." So I was pretty astonished, but I spent a week trying to write such a thing, and she said, "Okay, this is fine. Here's a contract." And I got a contract to write a book, and that became a book called Lawless World, which is still in print 10 years later, and which still sells, and which I still get asked to talk about, which addressed the function of international law in the world today, but in a way that was accessible for intelligent non-lawyers, but which nevertheless met academic standards. This was one issue that was very important. I have lots of fights with my publishers that I must always have footnotes and endnotes, because if I don't have footnotes and endnotes, it won't be part of the research assessment exercise, and I'll be sort of, you know, thrown out of the academic community. So I've got to have footnotes and endnotes. And so that was a different type of book. It wasn't a normally academic book, but when I go back and read it now, it's still sort of, you know, I don't express personal opinions, I don't talk about anything personal. It's still in that classical mode. Then 3 years later, I wrote another one about the Bush administration lawyers, and that went a bit further. And that, I got a contract to write a big article in Vanity Fair magazine, and they said, "No, none of this academic stuff. We just want a story that is a terrific story, because you're sitting on fabulous material." So it's as though I've been pulled kicking and screaming into this new world. And this book marked another stage in the transition, which is I talked about personal things, which, as you know, is a very big no-no. As an academic, as a practitioner, you keep the personal out. But I felt that it was appropriate to do it in this context, because essentially the thesis of the book is that individuals really matter, and individuals can make a very big difference. And to really understand the law on genocide and the law on crimes against humanity, you need to know who were the individuals who invented those concepts and why they did it. Why they did it helps you understand what it was intended to do. And if you exclude why they did it, you can't fully understand the way in which the law emerged, what its historical genesis was, and what it was intended to do. And so I was very comfortable in one sense writing about that, because intellectually I understood it needed to be done. On the other hand, it is certainly true that my editor, the wonderful Victoria Wilson, constantly was saying to me, "We need more of the personal. We need more of this family-type story," which I didn't really want to talk about. And I'm now very glad that I did. I mean, I'm not for a moment saying that every academic article should be written in that way, but I think there is a place for it in explaining the reality of international law. And the reaction from the academic community, I mean, exclusively, with one exception, actually, which I think is extremely entertaining, has been incredibly positive. The legal community has been very positive, and the history community and the politics community and the international relations community have been very, very positive. Generally, I mean, they've got critiques, very fair critiques. But the only critical review, which I really enjoy and wear as a badge of honour, is from a very famous historian of that period, who described the book in a review as a first draft. And I just thought that review said a lot more about him than it did about the book.
Absolutely.
Because I was basically trespassing onto his territory, which of course I wasn't. I'm not a historian. I don't claim to be a historian. I don't have those skills. That's not my thing. I'm an international lawyer, and I'm proud to be an international lawyer. But if you go to the end of the book, you will see that there are, I mean, over 1,000 endnotes, which of course drove the editors, both at Knopf and Weidenfeld, mad, and they came up with all sorts of schemes to get rid of the endnotes. Firstly, I understood no footnotes. It's very interesting. If you put footnotes in a book, sales drop dramatically.
Yep.
Okay, it's really interesting. But if you put the same thing at the back of the book, okay, as endnotes, the drop in sales is less. And then if you do it without putting little numbers at the point in the page where the endnote is cycled, which is why the books go very irritatingly, as you'll see at the back, you have to put in the form of the words, and then he said, page 473, and then there's an endnote, then sales go back to normal. And it seems that if you put that little number in the page, it's a really big turnoff for a great number of readers. And so it meets, for me, my normal academic standards. Everything that needs to be noted and referenced is noted and referenced. It's not done in a way that CUP or OUP would do it, but I'm satisfied that I've met those standards. And there's been no critique at all from genocide scholars and international criminal lawyers that somehow I've bloody, 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 blah. So it's that very difficult straddling, but it proves that it can be done, that it's possible to write a decently selling book that meets academic standards. And that is exciting for me, because that says that what we do is socially and intellectually useful, and it is possible to reach a bigger audience whilst meeting our highest standards of scholarship.
Which I think is incredibly important. Yeah. And having looked at your endnotes, I can tell you that they do satisfactorily meet academic standards. And so the book actually does achieve both of those objectives.
But it'll be interesting to see what happens in the next research assessment exercise of whether they say, oh, you know, this is a...
I don't think we should worry about that. I'm conscious of the time. I know that there are more questions, but I know that also there are some drinks downstairs, and I think there will be an opportunity for people to nab Philippe when we go, if you want to come down and have a drink. So I think I want to say, from my point of view, it's been a fascinating evening. I was fascinated reading the book. I can listen to Philippe talking about it forever. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your questions, and I think we should all give Philippe a very large round of applause for what is a tremendous achievement. Do come downstairs. I think there are some drinks. There may even be the odd peanut down in the cloisters.
Peanuts we spoke to now.
I don't know.